So we're going to look at two topics. One's called buffers and one's called titrations. In these topics, we're going to start mixing together acids and bases. Up to this point, we've either placed an acid in water or a base in water, or maybe a salt that behaves as an acid and base in water. In these lessons, we're going to take acids and bases, mix them together, and see what kinds of scenarios we run into and what kind of calculations we can do with that. So our first topic is about buffers, and buffers are a type of common ion effect problems. It's not the only common ion effect problem we'll see as we move forward, but buffers are the first type that we will see. So let's define a buffer. A buffer is a solution that resists change to pH. So you could add a little acid, a little base, and it makes minimal changes to the pH if it is a buffer solution. Now that's the definition of a buffer. What we want to know is the recipe. What constitutes a buffer? What do you put together to make this solution that resists change of pH? Well, what it needs to be is either a weak acid or a weak base, and it's conjugate salt, okay? It just says, and it's salt. So that's what is the recipe for a buffer. Here's another way of looking at it. You could either have a weak acid and it's conjugate base salt. So let me pick a weak acid. Let's say it was HF. Okay, that's a weak acid. So there's its weak acid. What's its conjugate base? Well, its conjugate base would be F minus. Well, you can't just go to a shelf and pull some F minus off the shelf and mix it together with the HF. This is an ion, so it needs to be an ionic compound containing that. And so that's the salt containing the conjugate base of that weak acid, okay? Or it could be a weak base and its conjugate acid salt. So let me pick a weak base. Here is a weak base. So what would its conjugate acid be? It would be NH4 plus. It's different by adding the H to it, the H plus to it. And again, you can't just go and find some NH4 pluses on a shelf to put into the solution. What you find is an ionic compound, so I need a chloride or some kind of anion to make it a ionic compound, and that I can pull off the shelf. So a base with its conjugate acid salt. If I mix this together with this, or I mix this together with this, I will have created something that will resist change to pH. We're going to see how it works, what's happening on the molecular level that makes it resist change. We're going to learn to calculate the pH of these solutions and what its pH will be if we add a little acid or a little bit of base. So that's what we're going to be doing as we proceed through these lessons. So here's some examples of buffers. I've given you two, and let's see if these are the same ones. Okay, this is a different one. So I could have a solution that contains, now that's acetic acid, CH3, COOH. When we see this group, that's an organic acid group, and it's this hydrogen that's donatable, not these. Another way that we could see this written is we put the H at the beginning. This H comes at the beginning, C2H3O2. Sometimes you see acetic acid written this way. So if it contains acetic acid, and what does it have with it? Sodium acetate. So that is the salt containing its conjugate base. So there's its conjugate base, and as soon as I stick the Na with it, it's the salt containing its conjugate base. All right, now see how it's written here? This is a common way of showing a buffer. You always write the base first, a slash, and then its acid form second. And the reason for that order will become evident much later in our lesson series, but that's a typical way of seeing it written. Okay, so this would be a way of writing this buffer, if you know the concentrations. So I have a 0.3 molar ammonia, a solution and a 0.2 molar ammonium chloride solution. We could write it like this. This is sort of shorter anyway. Writing the base first and then the acid form second. Here's examples of what are not buffers, okay? We have a very specific definition, and I'm going to show you ones that are commonly confused, all right? This guy, solution containing HCl and sodium chloride. Well, where does HCl fit on our acid-base world? It's a strong acid. You cannot make buffers if you have a strong acid and it's conjugate-based salt, for reasons we'll see as we proceed. But you've got to make sure you tag in that they have to be weak to start with. All right, so I just talked about why HCl is strong and not weak. All right, here I want you to look at your definition or recipe, I should say, your recipe for a buffer. Look at this guy, this mixture. I'm taking CH3NH2 and mixing it together with the ammonium chloride, and I want the reason why this is not a buffer. Well, you should have picked C, because C is not the conjugate acid of CH3NH2. What is its conjugate acid? All right, CH3NH2, that's a base because it's a nitrogen with three groups attached. It is going to be a proton acceptor, so its conjugate acid would be, let's add another H plus to this, making it NH3+. So if I had a salt of this guy, it would be a buffer. So you could have salts of conjugate acid of some base, but it has to be this specific base if it is going to be a buffer. All right, now this is a very hard to recognize buffer, and it will become more evident, I promise, as we proceed through these lessons and start talking about something called a titration. You learned about titrations in General Chemistry 1. Let's see how in the world this could be a buffer. First of all, we've got sodium hydroxide and HF. I'm going to write HF, okay? It's a acid, all right? Sodium hydroxide. That's a base. When they react, they will do the neutralization reaction. An acid plus a base gives you salt plus water. All right, so look at the quantities. Which one do I have more of? I have more of the HF. So I have more of this, and I have less of this. This is important for it to be a buffer. Now what happens when this reaction takes place? The little bit of sodium hydroxide is going to react with some, but not all of the HF. Does that make sense? Rewind it if it doesn't. It reacts with some, but not all. While it reacts, I will use up all this and make some of this. Okay? So as the reaction proceeds, I add a little bit of this, it reacts with some, but not all of this, and produces some of this. So there's a period there, and what do I have quantity-wise here? I have a little more than twice the amount of this, and then I'll react with some of this, and I'll produce some of this. So once this stops, I will still have some of this. I will have some of this, and what have I created? I have created a solution that has a weak acid in it and its conjugate base. So anytime you have a weak acid, strong base combo where there's more acid than there was base, you're going to create a buffer. Even though you didn't start with a typical recipe, you created the recipe by way of this reaction. Now, I said at the beginning that buffers and common ions, they go together. So what we have to realize is what a common ion is, all right? So we're going to define it. You have two solutes, two things being dissolved in a solvent, and our solvent will be water, that contains the same ion, thus the common ion. So if I took this solution and this solution and mix them together, okay, they have something in common. They have an ion in common. Okay, so that's what I just mentioned. If you had this HF and you had the NaF present, okay, the question is, what ion do they have in common? Well, they're going to have the F minus. There's an F minus in HF, and there's an F minus in that situation. So let's write what happens when this dissolves. Actually, let me see what I have on this slide. You've got those two reactions right down there at the bottom, okay? You'll want to go ahead and write those down in your notes. You might want to pause it and write them down. But see what HF is doing? HF is reacting with water, and it's doing what weak acids do, okay? What is that sodium fluoride doing when you dissolve it in water? Well, it's an ionic compound. It just dissolves and breaks apart. Ionic compounds are strong electrolytes. So as it dissolves, it completely breaks apart into its ions. So these two things are present. Okay, so I want you to consider that top equilibrium there. And you come along and you dump some NaF into that solution, and you see the ions present. What does that extra F minus do to the equilibrium? I want you to think Le Chatelier's principle. Remember, when you apply a stress, it shifts to try to relieve that stress? Okay, so if we add the sodium fluoride, that extra F minus is going to shift that top reaction towards the left. All right, and that's what's going to happen. That's a common ion scenario there. It will always cause that to happen. So this shift that it's causing of that first reaction is called the common ion effect. So in a buffer, you've got a common ion because of the recipe. The ion of this is going to affect the equilibrium of this, okay, and cause a certain balance to occur between them. So that's what a buffer is in terms of it resists change in pH, though we don't know how yet. That's the recipe that makes up a buffer. And what we're going to do next is we're going to look at the calculations associated with buffers, learning how to calculate the most important property of a buffer, and that is its pH.